Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to welcome you all to this evening lecture on such a wonderful and inspiring topic, overcoming life-threatening hurdles, by a very renowned trainer of this state and one of the foremost trainers when the terminology trainers came into being in the early 80s. That's none other than Mr. Parimal Gandhi from Vadodara. And besides this inspiring talk, he will also be releasing his book with a very apt title, Can Surmount, which is sort of an autobiography highlighting how he overcame personal challenges and adversities multiple times, yet maintaining his balance, mental balance, and full of confidence how, you know, each adversity he took it as an opportunity. Of course, he'll be talking about it. And it's nice to see so many persons in spite of the rainy days. And I see all of you have come before. We are talking about a rainy day, but this person, he has weathered many a storm, you know, not a day, but many a storm in his life, overcoming so many challenges. And these what you call challenges or adversities started right from his student days. It's not that it came later on in life. And that is how one by one he overcame it. That means let it come from the expert's mouth. But before I say further, on behalf of AMN, all of you, I'd like to welcome him with a bouquet of flowers. As I said, he's one of the first trainers in the state and the country, because that is a time in, I think, the 70s, the word, I think, human resources was hardly born. Even when I was in management, we used to talk of personnel management and IR and all that. But that is the time, early 80s, where from our state, he's one of the first, and as I said, in the country also. And in spite of this, all these difficulties in life, he has managed to train over 100,000 participants, and that includes 1,000 trainers, because he conducts a lot of train the trainers programs as well across the country with a lot of different companies. So this is quite an achievement. And though originally from Ahmedabad, his, you know, education was in Baroda. He did chemical engineering, and because of the eyesight problem, he had to take a drop in the fourth year. He then switched to literature. And I remember when I was in Vadodara, he's my senior, but I've heard him as a wonderful orator and a debate person, I think in 1976 or 77. So, and that's how he could, you know, inspire himself to become a very renowned trainer and a very active trainer. And in spite of his difficulties, he could inspire others. And I don't want to really formally introduce him, because let's leave it to the expert, because as I said, he's a wonderful orator. Let him explain in his own words his life journey. But before I hand over to Mr. Parimal Gandhi, I'd like to read a paragraph from the back cover of his book, you know, which is so apt, and it describes a lot. This single paragraph says a lot. Parimal says about how he combats cancer 4 times. Blindness twice, undergoes a cardiac bypass, and battles with diabetes and hypertension while successfully pursuing a demanding career which takes him across the continents. See, in spite of all this, he could travel the continents. And we were just talking informally, and in middle of all this, Parimal Bhai shared that he has been to the USA 40 times. So, you know, and he's almost a year, I think, 4 decades plus this journey, so it's amazing. He recounts, while facing challenge after challenge, the most unexpected and amazing people help him not only remind our life, but also gives him the kick, you know. So this is about it. And I think in the end, we can take some questions if time permits. So once again, welcome Parimal Bhai to AMA, and all over to you. Let's enjoy your life journey once again. Thank you.
Divyesh Bhai, Mr. Vyas, and I see Rama Ben in the audience. one of the people who has seen me grow up. I see Tina in the audience, childhood friends. I see Preeti, I see Nishat, I see Falguni, I see so many people here who are my very own. I grew up in Ahmedabad, not far from here, in Parimal Society. I studied in St. Xavier's High School. And therefore, whatever I do in Ahmedabad has a very special meaning for me. Couldn't have done what I've done without my school. Such a strong foundation it laid. I see Preeti smiling away, my niece. There are so many people here who are really, if I'm not mentioning you, please accept my apologies, but I do need to get on with my presentation. We lost today someone that I really looked up to. I know that all of us looked up to him. So I would like to begin by paying a tribute to him. When I teach time management, I use this poem. Kal kal karte aaj haath se nikle sare bhoot bhavishyat ki chinta mein vartman ki baji haare pehra koi kaam na aaya ras ghat reet chala जीवन बीत चला जीवन बीत चला. I put up on Facebook today that Indian politics has lost its only gentleman. I want to first of all thank Ahmedabad Management Association. I have been here many times, and this gentleman, for example, has always helped me to tune my laptop, to get me speaking to a large group. He remembered me as the trainer who uses a horn. To call back my participants, I use a horn, a rickshaw horn, and he could remember that. So I'm delighted to be here. Thank you, AMA. I think this is the correct place for me to be releasing my book and to be making this presentation to you. It's a light-hearted book release. The subject matter is somewhat serious, but I have not taken it seriously, and I don't think you should take it seriously either. So I tend to talk about it in a very light-hearted way, because I think that is how we need to take the troubles of our life lightheartedly. Let me give you an executive summary of what has gone on with me. I'm 64 years old now. I was born in Dr. Ankleshwarya's hospital near Electricity House, like so many of us sitting here. And that was way back in 1953 on Vak Baras. So the Vak has come to me. I never stopped speaking. And as I look back on my life, it has really, truly stretched me, thank God. I understand theoretically the concept of boredom. But practically, I have not had a single moment of boredom. એટલે મને શાંતિથી બેસવા દીધો નથી અને મારે શાંતિથી બેસવું પણ નથી. આઈ હેવ હેડ 4 એપિસોડ્સ ઓફ કેન્સર. ધ બુક મેન્શન્સ ઓનલી 3. એન્ડ વેન આઈ ગોટ ધ 4th વન, બાય ધીસ ટાઈમ ઇવન માય ડોક્ટર હેઝ ગોટ યુઝ ટુ મી ટર્નિંગ અપ વિથ સમથિંગ ઓર ધી અધર. એન્ડ આઈ હેડ ગિવન ઇન ધ બુક એન્ડ હી સેઝ, વેલ, ધ બુક હેઝ 29 ચેપ્ટર્સ. I think you have just started your 30th chapter. એટલે એ પણ બધા નફટ થઈ ગયા છે. દે આર નોટ, દે યુ નો, દે થિંક દેટ ઓકે હી વિલ મેનેજ ઇટ. આઈ હેવ બીન બ્લાઇન્ડેડ ટ્વાઇસ. સો અબાઉટ 1.5 years અગો આઈ વોઝ ઓલમોસ્ટ બ્લાઇન્ડ. આઈ હેડ એક્સ્ટ્રીમ ડિફિકલ્ટી વિથ સ્ટેપ્સ બિકોઝ માય કોન્ટ્રાસ્ટ પરસેપ્શન વોઝ એન્ડ ઇઝ પુઅર. ઇવન ટુડે I am blind in my right eye and it requires a corneal transplant, but sometimes the left hand disturbs the right hand. I completed my treatment for bladder cancer only a month ago, and so my eye doctor says we will have to wait for your corneal transplant, so I'm waiting. So I've had 4 and one more will come up, and hopefully my vision will be restored and I should be, you know, looking at things like you look at things. I've had a cardiac bypass, and for this I have a song which I want to play for you. The heart issue is somewhat of a showstopper because it stops me from doing a lot of things, or it discourages me, not stops me, but discourages me from doing a lot of things that I'd like to do. For example, I would like to go to Kailash Mansarovar, but it's scary. And I have doctors who tell me you can't go, and I tell them that I don't pay you, although I don't, my doctors are my best friends. So I'm able to tell them this, that I pay you not to go there, or not to tell me that I can't go there. I pay you to make sure that I can come back. Go I will. You need to ensure that I will be able to come back. So hopefully someday India and China will get their act together. There will be a helicopter trip from Kathmandu to Kailash Mansarovar directly. I shall do my darshan and come back, or some other way. Let's see. This is a problem. I'm telling you this jalebi. I'm diabetic, but I'm a Gujarati. And if there is a hot counter serving jalebi anywhere, I get into an existential crisis. Aapne jeeviye chhiye shena mate. Anything else I'm able to say no to, anything else I'm able to manage, but hot jalebi is a real issue, and the jalebi actually sings to me.
Chini kam hai, chini kam hai, thodi thodi tujh mein hai, kam kam.
This is what it actually tells me. So I found a way. You get this guy, you know, it's a hot counter, he's making it in front of you. You smile at him, he smiles back. You tell him, make it very crisp. A crisp jalebi absorbs less sugar syrup. And then you get him to put it in the sugar syrup and get it out at once. I call this diabetic jalebi. We got to find our ways around these things. Okay. Salt is an issue. Oil is an issue. Though now cholesterol, they've let us out of that problem. So oil is not so much of an issue any longer. My, you know, cholesterol levels are good, so I can play with that a little bit. But even water is an issue. I am allowed only 1.5 liters per day, and 2 liters if I am willing to take a diuretic. So that's something I need to play with also. But life is not just what happens to you. What happens to you is your karma. It is what you do with what happens to you. So I've had 4 cancers, no problem. It's happened to me, I can't help it. I'm not a smoker. I don't drink a heck of a lot. I'm a Gandhi living in Gujarat. How much am I going to drink? I have some diehard friends. Okay, so yes, occasionally, but very occasionally. I don't chew tobacco. Yet I've had 4 cancers. Not my fault, my karma, fault of my previous births. My faults of my previous births. I accept it. But this having happened, what did I do with it? That is where my secret lies. I have not taken it to heart. I think we should not take ourselves so seriously. So I always say, dukh chhe, pan hun dukhi nathi. I consider myself Teflon coated, non-stick. Thaya kare, thai, thavanu chhe. I'm not wanting it, but I know that, you know, my life is a sine curve. So if I go up, the downer is coming, I know it. Thayu chhe to pachi, you know, one should expect. One should prepare for the worst and hope for the best. So, will you break or will you stretch? And I have always chosen to stretch. I have never considered, the labeling is also important. So if I call it a problem, I have already labeled it, I have judged it. But I call it a situation, a challenge. I will not use judgmental words for what occurs to me. I call them occurrences, neither positive nor negative. What you call it in your mind actually derails you. If I call it a problem, I am already derailed. It's a situation to be dealt with. In fact, I even go so far as to say, a prasad chhe, Bhagwan no prasad chhe. Accept it, embrace it, and try to get out of it. More about this later. It's the philosophy of my life.
मैं जिंदगी का साथ निभाता चला गया हर फिक्र को धुएं में उड़ाता चला गया हर फिक्र को धुएं में उड़ा
The alternative title for this book, Can Surmount, actually uses the word cancer. I love wordplay. And so Can Surmount. But the alternative title for this book was A Picnic in the ICU. A picnic in the intensive care, because that is what I do. I really enjoy every moment, no matter where it is. Barbadiyon ka shoz manana fazool tha. Barbadiyon ka jashn manata chala gaya. The greatest compliment, incidentally, that I get is when I live alone, and as a result, sometimes I have a problem, I'm alone, and I see fit to call an Ola or an Uber and go off to the hospital. And I tell the driver, look, I'm not well, I have a problem, so please drive carefully. They not only drive carefully, they are human enough to escort you all the way to the reception and make sure that you are safely handed over. They become your relative. And when I land up at the reception of the hospital, they say, but where's the patient? I think that's the greatest compliment, because the two, what I've just told you and what you see in front of you, don't match. I don't look like a four-time cancer patient. I don't look serious enough. And the next thing they ask is, okay, so you are the patient. Where are the relatives? And I say, you are the relative. It all began in 1974. I was in the engineering drawing room, and we were working on some drawing, machine drawing, and I suddenly lost my eyesight. In short order, I ended up, this is the kind of cornea that it ultimately becomes. The condition I suffer from is called bilateral corneal dystrophy. I am one in a million, so this condition is also one in a million. They said it's hereditary, but up to my great-grandfather, nobody had problems with their eyes, not of this nature. Two words, hereditary and viral, I think you know what they are, right? So it actually means I don't know. Anyway, so this is what it ultimately becomes. So the rest of the eye is working perfectly fine, but the tissue on top is opaque. It's like this watch. If something happens to this glass on top, even if the watch is working, you can't see the time. I'm very lucky that whatever condition I have is amenable to treatment. So if a corneal transplant is done, my vision gets restored. It's not a problem without a solution. That's why I consider myself lucky, that the problems that I have a solution. I prefer to see the good side. I refuse to see the downside of whatever is going on with me. So when people ask you to donate your eyes, it helps people like me. The last time, which is about 1.5 years ago, I underwent a corneal transplant, and I was sitting there, say, you know, because you have to wait. You are in a queue, and then the order in which the corneas come is the order in which they do the surgery on you. So I'd been waiting for a month, and I kept saying, "Abe maro varo kya re aavshe, you know, when is it going to be my turn?" And then I suddenly realized that I was praying for someone to die. And so I said to myself, I said, look, whoever you are, I will never know you, but I'm thankful to you, and please live as long as you possibly can and live as happily as you possibly can. I'm in no hurry. I don't want you to die for me to be able to see. Such a selfish act. Anyway, I landed up in Civil Hospital, Ahmedabad, which was the best eye hospital at that time. Unfortunately, that surgery didn't work. I was there for 6 weeks. Not the fault of the doctors. It can be the disease that I had, or it can be that the cornea just went opaque. It's just, I attribute it to bad luck and bad karma. Anyway, I was going blind. I still continued to drive. Maru kaam rokayu nathi. This is another wonderful thing. There was nothing that I wanted to do that I was unable to do, in spite of everything that has gone on with me, except Kailash Mansarovar. And there again, I'm waiting. The moment the opportunity comes, I'll grab it. So, driving was an issue. I couldn't see very well. I had this little motorcycle on which I used to go around. I was dangerous. I was irresponsible, because it is today that I realize that I could have hit somebody for no fault of theirs. I should not have been driving. Fortunately, I hit a donkey and a buffalo, and it was their fault. Anyway, studying was a problem. I couldn't read. I was reading with a magnifier. The time came when my wife was reading to me and I was appearing for exams. So I was writing exams. I stood first in the university, which is nice. Went out of engineering. I had to give up only such case. Somebody gave up chemical engineering to go to literature. But I did. So I passed my BA with literature and linguistics. And it had more to do with the other students who were not studying at all. Okay, less to do with me. You know, you've got to say the right thing. I loved reading. There was a time when I used to read a book a day. In vacations, it used to be 2 books a day. I've asked my doctors, so let me tell you, the problems I had with my eyes had nothing to do with my reading habits. But I had to give that up, sadly. That was the saddest part. For a period of about 20 years, I had to stop reading. Then came along computers and mobile phones with lovely LCD screens. You can increase the size of the font. I play with the technology and I continue life. And then I started thinking of Braille, learning Braille while I could still see. In literature, I studied this. In ancient Greece, they used to have these serial dramas. So every day, the story would move a little forward, like in our Hindi serials, right? And they used to be hand to mouth. So in the morning, the author would write the play. In the afternoon, they would practice it. In the evening, they would play it. Now, the hero and the villain had to be almost equally strong, otherwise there would be no suspense. And obviously, the villain could not win. If the villain won, the audience would beat up the author. So they didn't want to get beaten up. So ultimately, the hero had to win. Okay, so these were the parameters in which these plays were written. Now, they had, like we have Indra and Agni and, you know, the various devtas, our devtas are mostly good. But their devtas, they had good and bad devtas. So this villain who had nothing to do would pray to the bad devtas, get all manner of powers, and then become stronger than the villain, than the hero momentarily. So, there were a couple of episodes where the villain really beat up the hero and it looked like he was going to win. Now, the next morning, this author is scratching his head, ab isko bahar kaise nikalu isme se? How do I rescue the hero? He heard a big thud outside and he goes to see that there's a construction site where they are putting stone on stone using a crane, and one of the stones had fallen because the rope had torn. So he got this bright idea that evening. The episode started with the villain continuing to beat up the hero, but then suddenly from the skies a god descended, picked up the villain and bodily threw him out of the stage. End of the story. And so was born the concept of a god in a machine, the Deus ex machina. We have Naradji. Naradji always enters when there is a madagant, right? Where you are unable to unravel the situation. So Naradji comes in, find some way, if you do this, if you do that. You know, our various Gaur Maharajas also, ane mangal che, ane falanu che, ane pelu che, right? And the Gaur Maharaj says, but there is a way if we do this puja, god in a machine. In the movie Lagan, you have, these cricketers, Bhuvan and his team, they don't know anything about cricket. In comes a god in a machine, the English girl who teaches them cricket. Why did she help them? You have Birbal. In my life, to extricate me from the complexities of the plot, there has always been a god in a machine who has rescued me. unfailingly. That is why I begin my book with a statement: I don't believe in miracles, I depend on them. I depend on miracles. I'll give you a few examples, but I can only take two forward. Okay, we have, and the stage is set ahead of time. In my life, a Hungarian engine driver has been a god in a machine. Ashok Bhai, a school student who went to Mount Abu with his family, grew up to play a major role in my life. And there are two others, but there are many others. I will tell you the story of the first two. The magic began. Remember, I had a problem with my vision. So I needed to find a way to come out of that, right? Well, this Hungarian engine driver suddenly decides that he wants to become a doctor. So, studies medicine, becomes a doctor, then he decides that he wants to be an ophthalmologist. Then he decides to immigrate to the US. He goes to this godforsaken town in the middle of nowhere called Amarillo, Texas, and starts practicing ophthalmology there. But he has this incredible love for India. So for at every ophthalmology conference, he's a fixture. Wonderful sense of humor, big heart, incredible human being. I ran into him in Ahmedabad. Somebody told me, you got to see this guy. He is so clever with his hands. He's so skilled. I'm sure he can solve your problem. I went to meet him. He says, yes, it can be done. Don't worry. Come to Amarillo. We'll fix this problem. So I decided to invite him home for dinner. And to give him a lift was one of my uncles who had such a terrible ambassador car. The two of them arrived. We were waiting for him, my parents and I. And this uncle of mine signals to me, "Emne bahar kaad," because the door would not open from the inside. There was no handle. So I pulled him out. Okay, I opened the door and I started escorting him to the home. And again, this uncle of mine is shouting, "Parimal, Parimal." I said, "What?" "Mane pad bahar kaad." Because the driver door also would not open. Anyway, there we were, he told me to come to Amarillo, but I had no way to get to Amarillo. I had no money. Something interesting happened. Normally, even though I was reading with a magnifier, I would read the Times of India from end to end. But that day, I missed this one announcement, which my wife, who never used to read the paper, read and pointed out to me. And this is Dr. John Alpar. That was Rotary International sending us off to, sending five young men, young professionals, to the USA on a group study exchange program. So, a very blessed Rotarian from the Rotary Club of Ahmedabad South. I got in touch with that gentleman. He said, "Look, I can take you as a standby." And because we've already selected one candidate, but I like you. If something happens and this candidate doesn't come for the interview, for the final interview, then we'll take you on. He prepared both of us. Taught us about Rotary, taught us about the United States, taught us about India, what to expect. And we came to the interview here near Kalupur railway station. There's a hotel. And they called us in at 9 in the morning. My wife, I think, must know black magic. First of all, she managed to get me as a husband, is number one. Number two, the main candidate did not turn up. So I became the candidate for the Rotary Club of Ahmedabad South. This gentleman made me wait until 7 o'clock. He later told me, he says, I wanted the committee to see all the other candidates first and see you last. I got selected. I knew nobody. And they keep saying that, you know, all these things don't happen without influence. They do. It happened without influence. I knew nobody. They selected me. Anyway, I was all ready to go to the US. We were making preparations when the next thing started, cancer. Before I could leave for the United States, I was diagnosed as having cancer of the lymph glands, which is called Hodgkin's disease. So I had a problem. The trip was to go, it's a time-bound thing. So the group study exchange program would start on time and somebody else would go instead of me. That is how it has always been in life. Want to play you a song? Always a challenge, always a challenge. No one in their right mind would postpone cancer treatment. Now, I told you about Ashok Bhai, that gentleman whom, that student whom my family met in Mount Abu. Normally, families don't keep up with each other. How many addresses have we taken and never followed up? Our families kept up with each other. My sisters tied him a rakhi. If we went to Mumbai, we went and met them. If they came to Ahmedabad, they came and stayed with us. This gentleman took my wedding pictures. He's a Palanpuri Jain. Becoming a diamond merchant was definitely in his blood, because all his uncles on both sides of the family, diamond merchants. This guy decides to take up medicine, decides to take up oncosurgery, and trained himself to become one of the foremost cancer surgeons in the country, head of the department at Tata Cancer. The setting had already been done. This is true for all our lives, let me tell you. I've had the time to think. Therefore, I can see this pattern. It is true for your lives also. If you sit back and think now, you will realize that people have come into your lives who have been put there to help you. So, we went to Dr. Ashok Mehta. There he is. In March this year, he is 80 plus now. He stood when a urologist was doing my cancer surgery, because the fourth cancer was bladder cancer. He says, I will be there when your surgery is occurring. Now, he also happened to be a Rotarian. So he understood the group study exchange program. I asked him this one question. I said, Ashok Bhai, you mentioned that I have a slow growing cancer. Can I postpone the treatment by 6 weeks or by 8 weeks? I'll go to the USA, take part in the program, get my eye surgery done and come back. Because this opportunity is not coming my way again. He says, I'm not saying yes and I'm not saying no, but there is now a new machine. normally the procedure then was, if there is cancer in the body, cut open the body from here all the way up to here and then look visually. Okay, no problem. No problem. No problem. This was cancer surgery of that time. It was called a staging laparotomy. It like cancer kaya stage per se, you know, at what stage is the cancer? That is what they were trying to figure out. If I did that, I was laid low for 6 months. It took 6 months to come out of the surgery. He says there is a new machine now called the CAT scan. It had just come. There was only one machine in India at Nanavati Hospital. He called up Nanavati. He says, sorry, my friend, you are out of luck. There is a waiting list for 1 month. And where do you think I was the next morning? I was at Nanavati Hospital at 9 in the morning. Again, some black magic. The first patient did not turn up. I got taken in. Remember, to win a lottery, you got to buy the lottery ticket. So from your side, the effort has to be 100%. Luck will favor you. Luck cannot not favor you. CAT scan done, the disease had spread to only one place nearby. There was no disease anywhere else. It had not metastasized. I went off to the USA, underwent the group study exchange program, incredible program. And there I was reading with the magnifier, and one of the families says, how come you're reading like this? I said, I have a problem with my eyes. They said, we have a lady here called Dr. Meenakshi Desai. Her husband is a urologist. She is a phenomenal ophthalmologist. Town of 55,000 people. We would not take this kind of a town seriously. Kada chano nampan nao mapper in India. But they had a urologist and an ophthalmologist. So I ended up with her. She says, this can be resolved. I don't do corneal transplants, but John Alpar is a well-known name. If he's willing to do it for you, go to him. It'll be done. I said, Meenakshi Ben, paisa nathi. I have $500. That won't even pay for the ambulance ride in the United States. She says, thashe kai. Let's see. Okay, so these folks, God bless their hearts, they both passed away. John and Eloise Turrell. They started a Parimal Gandhi Corneal Transplant Fund, collected $6,000. Gave it to me and said, Ja jee le apni zindagi. Incidentally, Dr. Meenakshi Desai's father and my father used to eat fafda together at the sports club. One more setting. And I'm pretty sure that she got them, because she, her husband was also a Rotarian, she got them to start this. No coincidences in life. We tend to see the negatives. Manau thai go, pelu thai go, am thai go. We do not see the positives. So there I was in Amarillo, Texas, in this hospital. Something interesting happened. We were going from Dallas to Amarillo, and the pilot came over and said, are you a patient of Dr. John Alpars? I said, yes. He said, you got to carry this box for him. It's very important, be very careful with it. So, okay. I was carrying my cornea in my lap. Anyway, no problems, it got done. I came out of the operation theater. They'd given me general anesthesia because they found me to be too frisky a patient. And when I came out of anesthesia, there were two people, Dr. Mahendra Patel, the anesthesiologist, and Dr. John Alpar. So Dr. Mahendra Patel was first. He says, I'm glad the surgery has gone well. You'll be able to see. And I've decided not to charge you. I said, thank you very much. I was staying with him. He had come to the airport to pick me up, sight unseen. I mean, all this happens. People who don't know you from Adam, they are not even Indians. They collect $6,000. So much kindness. Anyway, and he says, what Dr. Alpar is not telling you is that he is not going to charge you either. મારે એ હંગેરિયન એન્જિન ડ્રાઈવર જોડે શું લેવા દેવા કે એણે મને ચાર્જ ના કરવો જોઈએ. સો આઈ હેડ માય $6,000 ઇન્ટેક્ટ. આઈ કુડ યુઝ દેટ ટુ ટેક માય કેન્સર ટ્રીટમેન્ટ ઇન ધ યુએસએ. સો આઈ સ્ટેડ ઓન. Had some incredible experiences. And tamne keto jo tamne ente ka manas, it's like fiction, but it's the truth. Anyway, haji. Sorry. No, I have not. I will certainly read it.
On the very subject you are talking, miracles do happen. And if you decide within yourself, decide to go, it will go.
Ne, loko ni jindgi ma ek thai chhe, mari jindgi ma anek thaya chhe. I mean, he's my elder brother, my cousin. He's seen me go through this life. Anyway, an American came to stay inside me. He's still here in this eye. This is how it occurs. They take the donor cornea, they remove a button from your cornea. They take a slightly larger button from the other eye, stitch it onto your eye. So currently in this eye, I have 32 stitches. And this eye worked very long. Normally, a cornea has a life of 10 years. Mine lasted 25 years. And this lasted the longest, although it was 5 years older than this one, simply because this is the rotary cornea. It came with all the blessings of the Rotary Club and those people who contributed. I can't see any other reason why this lasted longer. But I have an American living inside me, and I have a Kannadiga living inside me, because this, okay, thank you. So, this cornea was done in Bangalore 1.5 years ago. So, I'm assuming that it was somebody from Karnataka. I got a new vision. All kinds of interesting things happened when I went back to Dallas. I asked my sister, I said, have you shampooed the carpet? Because the shade of the carpet had changed totally. They had these huge, thick telephone directories at that time. And I would read the telephone directory just for the joy of being able to see and read those minute letters. I could see them clearly. So there were some 487 Patels in the Dallas telephone directory and some 600 and something Shahs. And I read all the names, how many Shahs, how many Patels, Gandhi Ochad. Oh, the girls were prettier, I'm telling you. Evi maja hoti thi because I could see them. Couldn't see them earlier, they were all blotches. Now I could see, and the men were more handsome, but that is not important. Anyway, I ended up in Houston at the MD Anderson Hospital. I chose that, I did shopping. So I looked for somebody who would not do a staging laparotomy, and that was MD Anderson. Ended up there, ended up with a cousin of mine. So this is Hodgkins, Houston, Hemant and Hegemeister. Hegemeister was my doctor. Uma was my cousin, again another setting. We had lost touch with that family when I moved to Baroda. We got re-established with each other and these were my own, they were my cousins but they were my friends. It's Uma Nagarshet. She is an alumni of the first batch of SEPT, an architect from Baroda who postgraduated here in Ahmedabad. She's a dancer, a choreographer, an actress, a directress, teaches dance in Houston. At that point, she had three little children. And the couple themselves, so five people, plus two of her sisters had immigrated. So there were seven people living in that home, and they still took me on for a period of 9 months while I underwent chemotherapy and radiation. Just amazing. When I think back today, when I realize, I mean, shu jawabdari lidi thi. If there is God on earth, there are two forms. One is Dr. John Alpar, the other is Uma Nagarshet. Well, I took chemotherapy. Chemotherapy is actually poison. It kills all fast-growing cells, good and bad. Cancer is fast-growing cells. Now, the normal fast-growing cells come back. And the hope is that the cancerous fast-growing cells don't come back. In my case, I think they like me, so they want to keep coming back. But I thought I was going to die. At that point in 84, when someone had cancer, they used to say cancer is cancel. But I lived longer than I thought. I'm fortunate that my calculations were wrong. And I have lived longer than I planned at that point or had thought of at that point. So I took chemotherapy, I took radiation. In that radiation room, I had some pretty tremendous realizations. And I'm going to read from the book a little bit. It was in that room that I decided to extract my priceless life out of each remaining moment and not live it, let it pass unlived. Every moment just passes. You don't have a choice. You cannot stop time. So it's going to just go on. Now, the only choice I have is, can I live it fully? And that is why quality of life is far more important than quantity of life. And I made quality of life my aim. But as I told you, my calculations were topsy-turvy. I lived much longer, thank God. You know, I want to live. I have no problems with living. And it was, see, in this radiation room, nobody can accompany you. There's only God and you. Nobody will enter the radiation room with you, however much they may love you. It was in that room that I decided to stop working on jobs that could harness only a small part of my potential. The first rupee that I ever earned came out of conducting training back in 76. So I have been now a trainer for 42 years. But it was in, I was doing it part time. In 84, I decided I am now going to do it full time because that's what I love to do. I had no clients. My father said, I have worked for ACC, Associated Cement Companies, my entire life. They have not sent me for one day of training. Tane kaam kon aapse? I said, I don't know. But this is what I'm going to do. And I have never looked back. I have never regretted that decision. My profession is why I'm alive. I consider myself a traffic policeman for positive thoughts. Every day, if you're talking only positive things, you can't go wrong. It was in that room under those healing rays that I decided to take up training as a full-time profession. It was in that room that I decided to travel the world. And I have carried it out with a vengeance. So, tamare sastu takau traveling karvu hoy across the world, consult me. Believe me, I can really show you ways to do it. And yet, the most amazing experiences. I have lived in Japan with the Japanese, I have lived in Australia with the Australians, I lived in Peru with Peruvians, I have lived in Brazil with Brazilians. I had never seen a football match here in India. There I ended up in the semi-finals of the Brazil Cup. The first day I landed in Brazil, I was in a game. All thanks to my Brazilian host. I can really be a consultant to you, unpaid, on how to do it. Okay. It was in that room that I decided that I would not let the opinions of others guide my destiny. We give too much importance to others. If you ask them, they'll tell you they don't care. They want you to be happy. But we sit there and think, e shu kehshe, e shu vicharshe. And I have always believed, if I think about what they think, what will they think? Leave their thinking to them and live your life, for God's sake. Anyway, I wanted to travel the world, like I told you. I had made that decision. As you know, I had nothing in my pocket. I wanted to go to Europe and travel around Europe using the Eurail pass. And I needed about $500 to be able to do it. I had already spent the $500, I had already spent the $6,000. Some other people had given me some more money. I had already spent all that on my treatment. So I was on a Visit USA ticket. Some of you old timers would remember that ticket. So I was on a WUSA ticket, so I used it to the maximum. And I used my cousin network. There are always cousins and friends, you know. So I ended up with a cousin in Los Angeles. And they said, we'll take you to Las Vegas. I said, no, I don't believe in gambling. I don't have money to gamble anyway. They said, don't worry, you don't gamble, you watch. I said, okay. So I went along. And my cousin gave me $50. And she says, you gamble. Foini, saga foini chokri. I said, no, I can't gamble. I can't do that. She says, no, I don't want this money back. Even if you lose it, it's okay. But having come here, you have to experience this. Now, the lowest coin that you can get is a 5-cent coin which they call a nickel. That's the lowest with which you can gamble. So I put in 5 cents. I hit the jackpot with the first coin, got $700. I am from Ahmedabad. I am telling you, I am not going to gamble more. I did not put in any more coins. I took my $749.95, gave back $50 to my cousin. She says, nothing doing. And I traveled around Europe. So I could do the Golden Gate Bridge and the Eiffel Tower and many, many, many other places. Now I come back to India and the customs man asks me, so sir, what do you have to declare? How do you declare a cornea? And of course there's no customs duty on it, thank God. And how do you declare a new vision? I was stumped. I didn't know what answer to give him. And he thought that that silence was very suspicious. So he went through my baggage. You know, ye vakat bahut ye log ko pareshan karta tha. There was nothing. I had no money to get anything, in any case. Anyway, I believe that I am paying off my karmic debt. Why are all these things happening to me? Because somewhere back there, I have done some terrible things, which are now visiting me. But I have also done some wonderful things, which is why I have such wonderful people entering my life after the problem. Now, in spirituality, what you want to do is you want to exhaust your positive and negative balances. I think in one life, I've exhausted a lot of balances, thank God. That I'm able to remain happy in spite of all this happening. Somewhere, there are a lot of good karmas. I'm just going to conclude. This is one other very important thing. You know, we buy this wonderful crockery and then keep it. Koi sara guest aushe to. Arre bhai, you are your best guest. Use the crockery. Somebody gives you a good pen, you lock it up in the cupboard, your son finally opens the cupboard when you are gone. And he inherits the pen and he doesn't use it either. Why? Papa ni pench. There's this lovely Gujarati song. I would like to sing a couple of lines for you. In conclusion, just two more slides to go. चरर चरर मरु चकडो चाले चाकड़ चूची ची चाकड़ चूची ची चाले आजे रोकड़ा ने उधार काले. Now what he's saying is today is ready cash, tomorrow is उधार. You have to live in this moment. चकडोल चढ़े ऊंचे नीचे जीव तर एवू चढ़तु पढ़तु घड़ी माँ नीचे भाग्य सहुनु एवुरे फरतु नसीब नी नी शाले चाकड़ चूची ची चाले. This is how I end the book. I really don't know how all this is going to end, but I propose to make it a happy ending.
Before we release the book formally, I'll take 2 minutes. I had a last moment plan. I told Parimal Bhai that before he speaks, we'll release the books. But I don't know what happened to me when I was speaking in the podium. I said, let us, you know, not even look at the book, but let us enjoy the journey. Our people who readers digest, ma, an armchair travelogue. Every day, emni life no aaja ek armchair travelogue. We witnessed his life in an armchair, so that was wonderful. And besides so many inspiring things he told us, one of the most powerful things that we will all conclude, that as he said about duk, you know, कि भाई पेन इज इनएविटेबल बट सफरिंग इज वॉल्युंटरी इट्स अ चॉइस आपणे सफर थाव के ना थाव ते आपणा हाथमां छे सो आई थिंक दिस इज द मोस्ट पावरफुल मेसेज टुडे एंड बिफोर वी रिलीज द बुक्स लेट्स गिव अ वेरी बिग राउंड ऑफ अप्लॉज टू परिमल गांधी See, so much of, I think you'll all agree with me that after he spoke, there's so much of positivity today we can feel. So many of us are inspired. We have all these small problems day and after. We're worried about something at home, something at work, somebody's sick, we are sick and all that. But then looking at all this, they are all really all minuscule. And plus we are learning how to overcome this. So now let's, the big moment, let's release the book, please. Anyway, with all these wonderful, inspiring messages, I don't want to say anything more, but a big thank you on behalf of all of you.
Oh God.
Small
Oh God. You didn't have to do this.
Thank you so much. Wonderful.
Thank you.
You sign this for me?
Yes, of course.
Blessings.
I will gladly do it.
Yeah. Friends, thank you very much for attending and wish you all a very good evening.